Good afternoon. I'm Daniel Benjamin. I'm the director of the Dickey Center, and I'm delighted to welcome you to this book talk on Defying Convention, U.S. Resistance to the UN Treaty on Women's Rights by Dartmouth's Professor Lisa Baldez. This is a fascinating book on one particular international human rights treaty, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, otherwise known as CEDAW, and particularly on the politics surrounding the issue of the United States Senate giving its advice and consent, or as we more commonly term it, ratifying it. The book is much decorated. It has won the 2015 APSA Award, American Political Science Association Award for the Best Book on Human Rights, and it won an award also from the same organization, the 2015 Victoria Schuck Award for the Best Book on Women and Politics. And I confess that I got that email from Government Department Chair and Dean Lacey a while ago, so I wanted to check and see if there were any more awards that had come in since then. Lisa characteristically doesn't post any of them on her website. And so I went to Amazon, because they often pile those things up to make you buy the book. And I was astonished. I was surprised to find that there wasn't mention of any awards there, and that's probably because Lisa didn't tell them. But there was, right under the picture of the cover, an ad that had been inserted, which struck me as encapsulating the true absurdity of our internet era, because the book that was being advertised was called Government Zero. No borders, no language, no civilization. And it's about, it's by the, I would say, paleo conservative Michael Savage. And in this book, he reveals the massive dangers currently leading to the demise of our government. It sounds the alarm about how progressives and radical Islamists are each unwittingly working towards similar ends to destroy Western civilization and remake it in their own respective images. Well, so this is a much better book. And I've read this one, and I haven't read the other one. It's a remarkable chapter in the history of American exceptionalism, and especially American exceptionalism when it comes to international law, advances in global governance, and in particular, the development of instruments to advance women's rights. Professor Baldez traces the arc of this convention from the early discussions in the wake of the creation of the United Nations in 1945 to the present. And it's worth noting, I think when the book went to press, there were only 185 countries that were parties to the convention. There are now 189. The only non-ratifiers are Iran, Sudan, whose leader is under indictment by the International Criminal Court, Somalia, which has been a failed state for most of the period that the convention has been open for signature, the United States, and Palau and Tonga, which I'm sure are waiting for a signal from us. It is worth noting that Saudi Arabia is a signatory to CEDAW, is a signatory, and has ratified CEDAW. Professor Baldez gives us a really vivid account of the politicking both in Washington and in the society more broadly around the convention, and analyzes the gender politics that have made ratification a more distant prospect with each passing year. She also presents a very compelling description of the utility of the convention beyond symbolism and really advancing women's rights. I think most of you know that our author, Lisa Baldez, is professor of government and also in the Department of American, Latino, and Caribbean Studies, and she is perhaps most famous on campus now for being the director of the Dartmouth Center for the Advancement of Learning. She is also the author of Why Women Protest, Women's Movements in Chile, which came out in 2002, and has co-edited a book, Political Women and American Democracy, Critical Perspectives on Women in Politics Research. To close on a more personal note, I just want to say how pleased I am that Lisa agreed to do this event, or I should say acceded to my badgering. The Dickey Center has made it a goal to build our programming and research in the area of gender, and so I'm especially pleased that we have this excellent book to discuss. And I think there's a great deal that we can learn from its examination of how gender politics have frustrated the efforts to strengthen this convention and the global rights of women. So with that, I turn it over to you.
Thank you so much. It's so nice. Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Sharon Trubu-Martin, for arranging this event. Thank you also to the Dickey Center for hosting a manuscript review of this book in its early stages a couple of years ago. The Dickey Manuscript Review is a process that many Dartmouth authors have been able to participate in, and it's been invaluable for basically improving the work that we do here. And I do want to note that opportunity allows us to bring in outside experts from around the country. Luckily, one of the foremost experts on CEDAW was not too far away, Vermont Law Professor Stephanie Ferrier, who I'm very pleased is here today. And thank you all of you for coming today. It's nice to see you, and it's fun to do this audience. So I'm going to be talking about CEDAW, and I'm going to be saying the word CEDAW a lot because it would be really a mouthful to say convention to eliminate all forms of discrimination against women over and over again. And this is kind of the global, this is what the globe does. So CEDAW is basically a global bill of rights for women. It articulates a set of global norms that defines discrimination against women in all arenas of social, political, economic, and cultural life. And it obligates countries that ratify it to take positive action to eliminate discrimination against women. It also establishes a regular process of reporting and compliance to ensure that countries actually hew to the promises they make. So as Dan mentioned, 189 countries have ratified CEDAW so far. That's second only to the Convention on the Rights of the Child in number of signatories. Now, as Dan also foreshadowed for you, who hasn't ratified CEDAW? Iran. Palau, although Palau did sign it in 2011, thus signaling an intent to ratify, Somalia, Sudan. Now, when at the time that I wrote the book, South Sudan had not ratified, but I just found out recently they ratified in April 2015. Tonga has not ratified, but in April, the prime minister declared an intent to ratify, so they're very close, and of course, the United States. So Tonga, so most people, I'm assuming most people in the United States haven't heard of CEDAW, don't know that CEDAW exists. That's my experience. It's not this, it's not that way in Tonga. CEDAW is very visible in the political arena today. And here's some documentary evidence from some protests about CEDAW. Now it's very unusual to see people this fired up about CEDAW, but they are in Tonga. And as you can see, these are in opposition to CEDAW. So the prime minister said, we're going to ratify CEDAW. And then a lot of civil society groups and the Catholic Church said, nuh-uh. And there have been a lot of protests and back and forth for the last couple of months. Here's another picture. Jesus is freedom, not CEDAW. That should have been the title of my book. CEDAW is not for Tonga. And these kind of the ferocity of these arguments echo what we see in the United States, although what we see in the United States we don't actually see because it's been largely confined to Senate committee rooms, which I'll talk about at the end of the talk. So my book looks at three questions. One, how did women's rights come to be a global norm and kind of where did CEDAW come from? Why hasn't the U.S. ratified CEDAW? And the reason I got interested in CEDAW is because I study Latin America. I study gender in Latin America. In Latin America, CEDAW is part of the policy environment. Everyone knows CEDAW, everyone's ratified CEDAW. All organizations use CEDAW as a point of reference. It defines the agenda with regard to women's rights, and it's kind of a tool that activists typically use and governments. And then finally, what impact does CEDAW have? So today I'm gonna focus on the history of the treaty, how the treaty came to be. I anticipate that the other two questions will come up in the Q&A, and so I'm gonna talk about, save them for that. So I consider the formation of the UN in 1945 and the UN Charter to be real starting points for the drafting of CEDAW. The UN was created, most of you know this, I'm sure, in 1945 in an effort to kind of create an international organization that would promote peace in the aftermath of World War II. So let me start by reading you the first two articles of the preamble to the UN Charter. There's a picture of it, the first article in the preamble. We, the people of the United Nations, determined to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war, which is twice in our lifetime, has brought untold sorrow to mankind. And number two, to reaffirm fundamental human rights, faith in fundamental human rights, and the dignity and worth of the human person in the equal rights of men and women and of nations large and small. So that is pretty extraordinary to me, that this is really that high up in the introduction to this very important document. And so I started trying to figure out, well, why? Who did that? This was not a time in the United States history known for kind of strong feminist movements supporting women's rights. Part of the answer lies with John Sloan Dickey. And this is a funny, you know, one of those serendipitous things that you find in the archives. So in the aftermath of World War I, the League of Nations was created, and Woodrow Wilson was very heavily involved in the effort to draft the Treaty of Versailles. When it came time for the Senate to ratify, the US Senate to ratify the Treaty of Versailles, the Senate voted against ratification of the Treaty of Versailles, which is a very humiliating episode for the United States and certainly for Woodrow Wilson. So when it came to the United Nations, the US government, the State Department in particular, wanted to be very sure that the US Senate would ratify or vote to it, give its advice and consent. So the State Department launched a huge mobilization effort to let people know about what this new organization was going to look like. So they had the draft proposal of the UN, kind of the architecture of the UN, and they distributed hundreds of thousands of copies all over the US to schools, civic organizations, municipal governments. Several governors declared a week of reflection on what was, it was called the Dumbarton Oaks proposal. So this is a huge mobilization effort. Not surprisingly, out of that mobilization effort, it came to the fore that this was an organization focused largely on security. And what people wanted was for it to focus on human rights. So then there became a demand for women's organizations, all kinds of organizations, black rights organizations, to demand a place at the table at the formation of the UN, and that their issues be incorporated into the text of the Charter for the United Nations. So here we have a picture of, this is a delegate from the American Association of University Women participating. This is the fruit of the efforts to get women participating in this, the drafting at the conference in San Francisco in 1945. And it also galvanized black organizations, the NAACP in particular, who hoped to use the UN to press for an end of discrimination in the United States. So the text of the UN Charter, this language, reflects those efforts. I'll say a little bit more about what happened in just a second. So there are some histories about global women's movement and histories of UN and the histories of UN women's organizations, and they trace what looks like a very clear progressive arc that starts with the UN Charter. It goes to the creation of the Commission on the Status of Women, a couple of minor conventions, culminating with the drafting and ratification of CEDAW. My argument is that it was not at all a smooth arc. And in fact, the United States government set out to challenge, to limit, and to prevent the United Nations, and particularly the Commission on the Status of Women, from having any impact at all on the status of women in the domestic level. And this was linked both to arguments within women's rights community, debates about what was the best way to proceed, but also reflected an effort to keep the UN weak when it came to domestic jurisdiction because of the efforts of African-American organizations to hope to use the UN to combat discrimination, racial discrimination. So over the course of this time, what my research traces is the United States government explicit efforts to obstruct any progress whatsoever in the global arena of women's rights. Looking at the audience here, I'm guessing most of you are gonna look at this map and you're gonna know what it conveys, the Cold War and the two dominant powers, the Soviet Union and the United States, as they are spatially arrayed from the period of the post-war period until the 1990s. One of the reasons that the U.S. State Department sought to prevent this, the Commission on the Status of Women, from having any power was to prevent the Soviet Union from being able to use the UN to promote its agenda. Meanwhile, the Soviet Union was trying to prevent the U.S. from using the United Nations to promote its agenda. Southern politicians in the U.S. also feared that blacks would use the UN to promote a racial progress agenda. The Soviet Union picked up on those arguments as well and often used them in the context of the UN. So in this context, the U.S. consistently supports policies that kept these efforts weak and ineffectual. So there were very specific instructions within the Commission on the Status of Women. I mean, this is like they met once a year for a couple weeks at a time. But the State Department would send explicit instructions that said, make sure you combat the Soviets on every single claim they make to represent women's equality, and oppose any proposal that would require governments to take concrete action to actually promote some kind of women's rights that could be adopted at the domestic level. So when you read the archives of the Commission on the Status of Women, it's like this propaganda war between the Soviet delegates from the Eastern and Communist bloc countries and American delegates and their allies, both claiming to represent women's real interests and kind of combating with each other there, but also engaged in efforts to kind of make sure that any proposals, and there was often a proposal to create a treaty on the global rights of women that would have real impact, were derailed. And here's an image. This is just a Soviet propaganda poster. What it reads is, women enjoy the right to vote and to be elected on an equal basis with men. Long live Soviet women's equality. Now, we could spend a whole lecture just talking about this and what this really means and where it comes from. But I just meant to evoke the idea that the Soviet Union saw itself as the global leader on women's rights and women's equality and did not want any competition from the United States. And the UN became the arena in which these conflicts were duked out. So they did get a series of conventions passed, those relatively minor conventions. Let me go back to those. The Convention on the Political Rights of Women, which was passed in 1952, guaranteeing that women had the right to vote and run for office. 1952. Now, there were still many countries in the world where women did not have those rights, but most of the UN member countries did have those rights, so this was kind of a nominal nod toward rights for women. Convention on the Nationality of Married Women. Nationality of Married Women was a very pressing issue in the post-war period, but a fairly narrow scope. And then there was a declaration, which is a statement of support for elimination of discrimination against women, but had no binding impact whatsoever. So this is all important architecture, but there's really nothing substantive happening here. This changed in the 1970s. And some accounts that there are about, you know, what changed, what made it possible in the 1970s for this kind of deadlock between the two superpowers to break apart, points to détente, the general thawing or easing of hostilities between the US and the Soviet Union that went from about 1969 until the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan in 1979. And I'll show you some images. I'm kind of a big, this is one of my favorite foreign policy eras, and I am total geek. Here we have Nixon and Brezhnev talking about the strategic arms limitation talks, round one. Nixon's famous visit to China, immortalized in the opera, Nixon in China. And of course, and this was big if you grew up in the 70s in Washington, D.C., China's gift of pandas to the National Zoo. Now, I also have some actual detente kitsch. This is one of my most prized possessions, the Nix Mao ping pong set, which is a memory from ping pong diplomacy, in which the United States government sent a ping pong team to challenge Chinese ping pong players, who were, of course, world famous. And that was actually the opening that facilitated Nixon's trip to China, ping pong. And I bet each of you has a story to tell that's related to that. So all this is happening with detente, but that is did not lead to any thaw with regard to women's issues. In fact, the key change was a change in the balance of power within the UN General Assembly. It was not detente. So, early 1970s, US global credibility is not so great. In the era of Vietnam, Watergate, there's the role that CIA played in overthrowing the democratically elected government in Chile in 1973. So there was a lot of global opposition to US policy and US foreign policy in particular. What was happening within the UN General Assembly? Well, with wars of liberation and national freedom throughout the what was then called the Third World, the number of countries within the UN increased dramatically starting in 1960. So in 1960 alone, 17 new countries became members of the United Nations. And all the new member nations of the UN that joined in the 1960s were developing countries from the Third World. With the formation of the non-aligned movement, these countries formed at one time a pretty solid voting bloc within the United Nations. And they voted down they voted against the United States on almost every single issue. So one example. Every year since the Chinese Revolution, UN members had sought to have Taiwan was the official representative of China within the UN, and many members sought to have Communist China replace Taiwan as holding the seat for China within the UN. So this was brought up every single year. In 1971, I believe, finally the UN had enough votes to succeed in voting that Communist China would take Taiwan's seat. And when the Taiwan delegate left the arena of the General Assembly and the Communist Chinese delegate took his seat, the UN General Assembly erupted in celebration. People were dancing in the aisles. Here's a photograph. Okay, this was not a policy that the United States supported. In fact, the UN, the US permanent representative to the General Assembly in the next picture that I'm going to show you depicts how the United States felt about this vote and other votes. You'll recognize this person as George H.W. Bush. He's accompanied by who was then his aide, Daniel Patrick Moynihan. So the US comes to see the UN as a very significant foreign policy problem. Not a major one, we had a lot of other major problems. But the US, the status of the US was pretty disarray, to say the least, within the United Nations General Assembly. So in the next slide, I'm going to read you an excerpt from a CIA report to the State Department, one of many cables from that era highlighting the problems that the US faced in the UN. This one's from 1974. Sorry, I can't read it on this slide. The 1974 General Assembly drew unaccustomed governmental and public scrutiny to the UN. By the close of the 10-week session, Yasser Arafat had addressed the Assembly, Israel had been muzzled in open debate, South Africa had been suspended, and expropriation of foreign investments had been sanctified. LDCs, lesser developed countries, achieved each of these victories by applying their two-thirds majority with considerable efficiency and little restraint. As LDC victories accumulated, Western industrialized members not quite resigned to the role of automatic minority became increasingly restive. Western representatives suggested the Assembly under such circumstances had little utility for their governments. A growing sense of institutional crisis transformed the Assembly's closing agenda item, strengthening the organization, into an exchange of grievances. So this just gives you a flavor for increasing US concern and awareness about the status within the UN. So this is 1974 under President Nixon, and then we move into the Ford administration. And in the next slide, I'm going to read you an excerpt from a cable from Henry Kissinger, who was then Secretary of State, about how to respond to this crisis within the UN. And what he says, human rights, that's what we're going to do. We're going to promote human rights within the UN and UN member countries. Human rights issues are receiving increasing attention both by Congress, in part because of US foreign policy in Latin America, and public in US and in international fora with focus on alleged gross violations in specific countries. It is our desire at the 29th General Assembly to demonstrate our concern about human rights in all areas of the world in ways which can lead to effective measures, but avoid putting undue strains on bilateral relations. One measure of great importance is the Declaration on the Elimination of All Forms of Religious Intolerance, another UN document, which we strongly support but has been delayed by communist states. So we can go on and read it there. Now, this is a weird move, making Henry Kissinger into a harbinger of human rights. Requires a level of optimism that isn't necessarily associated, usually associated with Henry Kissinger. So it requires maybe an act of forced optimism. It didn't have a wide impact, but it had a very particular impact within the Commission on the Status of Women. And the Commission on the Status of Women, the US delegation to that organization, heard this message loud and clear and decided that they too would begin to support women's rights and human rights within the commission. There was then a proposal to name 1975 International Year of the Woman. And again, there was a lot of conflict between the Soviets and the US over this issue, largely because the Soviet Union wanted to host the International Year of the Women conference, and the US did not want the Soviet Union to host that conference. So they took the measure into the commission, and I'm going to read you, this is a cable from the UN representative, the US representative to the UN, about what happened at that meeting. Summary. Session characterized by emergence of the US in new human rights leadership role on issue of equal rights for women. Soviet opposition to US/less developed country-sponsored resolution asking UN to call women's conference during International Women's Year revealed clear Soviet bias against equality for women, a little bit of the old rhetoric. Timely release of presidential, from Nixon, International Women's Year proclamation during the session further underlined US dedication to equal rights principles. Created added support for US International Women's Year resolution and effectively stalled Soviet drive designed to focus worldwide attention on single communist Women's Year conference scheduled for Moscow in 1975. US initiatives. Republican administration, in integration of women into UN programs for development, family planning, observance of International Women's Year widely supported, and summary. It goes on. And this is the kind of thing that, you know, the payoff for spending a lot of time in the archives. LDC's support of question of equal rights came during a series of hard-fought battles with Soviets over issue of changing priorities to permit UN funding of International Women's Year conference. Soviet opposition and intervention by male members of delegation revealed strong bias against equality for women. 9 LDCs from all developing regions joined the US in co-sponsoring conference that won decisively, there's the vote, substitution of male member of Soviet delegation in chair during a futile filibuster effort created widespread antagonism among delegates. Generous and warm-hearted position subsequently adopted by USSR delegate who had been temporarily replaced by male colleague reversed the trend somewhat before the session ended, but did not materially affect wide propaganda advantage gained by the US move and Soviet blunder. So minor disputes within a committee have global consequences. As a result of this agreement, the UN went on to declare 1975 International Women's Year and held the first World Conference on Women in Mexico City in 1975. At that conference, and as a result of these forged agreements, the process of drafting the CEDAW, the Treaty on Women's Rights, could begin. And here's a photograph of the kind of opening ceremony of the World Conference on Women. This was one of 4 World Conferences on Women that took place between 1975 and 1995. And they really galvanized the global women's movement by bringing representatives from countries around the world and parallel NGO conferences in which thousands and thousands of people participated. And this really raised the profile and raised the level of sophistication with which the global women's rights agenda was developed. So this mobilized support for the drafting of a treaty that took it out of this tiny conference room and kind of put it onto the global agenda. And it helped to eliminate the impasse between the two superpowers. So in 1976, the Commission on the Status of Women begins drafting CEDAW in Geneva. The US government sends a delegation, and that delegation is comprised of women from the Republican Party and women from the Democratic Party. And here are two of the leaders, two of the only ones I could find photographs for on the internet. Patricia Huttar was president of the National Federation of Republican Women, and Marguerite Raywalt, a founding member of the National Organization for Women. Today, it is unimaginable that you would have these two women appointed to the same committee and working together to promote global women's rights, given the way that the parties have evolved. So there was a very important and very unusual moment in the 1970s of agreement and alliance between the two parties on support for women's rights. Not only that, but one of the most important issues for the State Department, this time under the Ford administration, a Republican administration, was protection for family planning. Another thing that's hard to imagine in this day and age when abortion politics are so clearly divided between the two parties. And the Republican Party, just to clarify, is not the one supporting family planning. So in the next slide, I'm going to read you just another cable. This is a cable that the State Department sent to these women who were negotiating the drafting of the convention in Geneva. The U.S. objective is to secure an explicit recognition of the importance of the provision of family planning services, I don't know what RPT services are, for the removal of sex discrimination and for the advancement of women. If the amendment efforts fail and the delegation is forced to abstain for the final document for any other reason, report for any other reason, the following statement is to be included in the explanation of vote. We also regret that the present text does not recognize the need for non-discrimination health care and the provision of family planning services. So if you don't succeed in getting it into the convention, issue a formal statement saying we regret that this was not included in the convention. So a couple of things here. One, we have a Republican administration under Nixon and Ford with Kissinger at the helm, being very adamant in support for women's rights, very explicit in their details, and very strongly supportive of family planning. This is precisely the issue on which the GOP will pivot dramatically in 1980, and we now find ourselves in that same reproductive rights regime, if you will. So the drafting process started in Geneva in 1976. It went on for several years within various committees within the United Nations, and eventually was opened for signature in December of 1979. At the Second World Conference on Women in Copenhagen in 1980, that was kind of the ceremonial opening of the convention. And that's a picture. It looks a lot like other world conferences on women, at least the dais. And the United States, under this is President Carter now, sent Sarah Weddington, who was a lawyer who argued Roe versus Wade before the Supreme Court, to represent the United States. And she signed for Jimmy Carter an intent to ratify CEDAW at that conference. And I have a quote here from Barbara Mikulski, who, as a member of Congress, attended this convention, conveying kind of what the hope and expectation was around CEDAW at the time. There was such buoyancy, such enthusiasm, such optimism, such hope that we're going to end discrimination around the world, and we're going to do it through a legal document through the United Nations. So let me sum up on this story about the drafting and the writing of this convention. So there's a statement of equal rights for men and women in the UN Charter that suggests a lot of promise, a lot of global support for that set of policies, but progress on women's rights was thwarted by the US in the context of the Cold War and conflicts with the Soviet Union. This deadlock shifted in the 1970s due not to détente, but due to shifts in the balance of power within the UN General Assembly itself. And then finally, what I think is so remarkable and so distinctive about this era is that it's US leadership on the issue of women's rights under a Republican, two Republican administrations, and a third Democratic administration that continued the same set of policies that led to the drafting of what would become a very important tool for advancing women's rights around the world. So I'm going to stop there and open up for questions. Thank you.
What is the distinction or the difference between the Declaration of Human Rights
and CEDAW? Why isn't CEDAW part of the Declaration of Human Rights?
That's a great question. I do devote a fair amount of time in the book to talking about that. Because there was certainly an effort by women's organizations around the world to put some of the planks that would later show up in CEDAW into the UN Declaration. But it's this same context of kind of global opposition, conflict between the two superpowers that mitigates against those kinds of planks being included in the Declaration on Human Rights. So what I document is very strenuous efforts to get women's rights written into the UN Declaration on Human Rights, which was passed by the UN General Assembly in 1948, most of which failed. And so that then created, there was an already mobilized constituency, but created continuing efforts to try to make that happen that weren't successful until CEDAW.
John.
Can you clarify, I'm trying to make sure I got in terms of the shift in the 1970s to human rights, and the United States championing human rights, was that really an extension of that Cold War rhetoric in terms of the perceived violations of human rights and torture and so forth, both in the Soviet Union and elsewhere, and in terms of revolutionary ways to get third world countries on the United States side to reverse that trend? And then women's rights gets folded into that and almost as an afterthought. Did I get your argument right, or is there something else going on?
So, there? I mean, I'm not sure. So the argument that I make is that there was kind of a break in kind of the types of arguments that the United States is making and their ability to succeed and in what context they were making those arguments. And what I hear you saying is that you see some continuity in the kinds of arguments that they're making.
You see a continuity there in terms of the issues about human rights being a way to reverse some of that Cold War politics in the United States' disadvantaged position there relative to the UN General Assembly.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, I do. And what's so interesting is that's really the first time that the U.S. government and the delegation and the directives from the State Department are saying, talk about rights and push women's rights. That had been exactly the opposite message of what had been relayed for several decades.
Yes.
Yes. If human rights do not include women's rights, does that mean that human rights reads men's rights? And that women are not human?
there's actually a large body of literature and questioning about that very topic. And there are many who argue, and many actually women's rights activists who argue that you don't need separate guarantees of women's rights because they are included within human rights. And so there was a lot of back and forth about whether you needed to separate out women's rights as something distinctive. That ultimately, those are the arguments that are reflected in CEDAW. You have a moment in 1995 at the Fourth World Conference on Women in Beijing. And this was not, Hillary Rodham Clinton was not the first person to say this, but she was the person who said it, and it really changed the tenor of how we think about women's rights. And she gave a very important speech at that conference in which she declared, women's rights are human rights, and human rights are women's rights, or maybe it was reversed. And that was a moment at which you could begin to talk about those two things together and kind of make explicit linkages between them. But there certainly was a sense that if human rights were women's rights prior to that, they weren't being addressed, and that there were issues specific to women that got masked and overlooked.
Lisa, what are the provisions of CEDAW? I mean, are there lots of them, or are there three or four, or what?
There are 30 provisions. They're broken up into different areas. There are kind of six general covering provisions that talk about the general obligation, that define discrimination. They offer the general kind of things that states are obligated to do and the kind of the way they approach discrimination. And then there are enumeration of specific forms of discrimination in areas of employment, education, rural women, health, politics, economics, all different areas. And then there's a final section that talks about the process by which the treaty is enforced. And there's a committee of 23, they're called gender experts, who are appointed to serve on the committee. What's really important is that those experts, they're obviously from countries, but they don't represent countries. So they're not the official US delegates. And they're elected by all the UN members of CEDAW. So they have tended, in large part because a lot of people ignored this treaty for a long time. Women who were very strong feminist advocates ran for that position and got elected, and were able to exert a lot of influence in terms of developing kind of a jurisprudence of interpretation of all of those provisions of the convention. So actually, the way that the treaty has been interpreted and implemented and applied to specific countries is surprisingly progressive. I think it's more progressive than any individual country, and the standards to which they hold countries, including Saudi Arabia and other countries that we don't consider to be fair paradigms of women's rights, is really quite impressive.
It was very interesting to listen to you when I had the opportunity to look a little bit in your book. CEDAW represents a very strong foundation because you can build on top of CEDAW many other laws and measures that reinforce women's position in the state. I saw with very high interest the reasons why CEDAW was not ratified up to now. But I would like to know what is a reason not to ratify now, because a UN is different than its 70s. And is it because of internal interest, non-interest, or it is still because of a different level of forces in UNGA?
First of all, so we haven't ratified, but it's not for a lack of trying. And the Senate has held hearings on CEDAW 7 times, including one I just learned about last night, last year. And I kind of generated a theory about, you know, what would be the conditions under which the U.S. would be most likely to ratify. First of all, it's hard to ratify any treaty in the United States. This is the treaty. This is the treaty provision in the U.S. Constitution of Article 2. The president shall have a power with the advice and consent of the Senate to make treaties provided 2/3 of those senators present concur. This is one of the highest thresholds for ratifying a treaty of any country in the world. Only 5 countries, Algeria, Burundi, Iraq, Micronesia, and the Philippines, have equally strenuous requirements. So it's just hard to ratify any treaty at all, as we know from recent politics. That said, we do ratify treaties, and we have ratified 4 of the 9 human rights treaties in the United States. So I developed a theory, and I said, well, given the politics around women's rights since 1980, since the convention came into force, we should expect that the most likely situation for the treaty to be ratified is when you have a Democratic president and a Democratic majority in the Senate. So I mapped it out, and the areas in blue are where you have those Democratic majorities and a Democratic president. And what you see is that those are precisely the moments in which CEDAW activists, and there are 100 organizations in the United States that have been mobilized around CEDAW, decide to hold hearings. So Carter sent CEDAW to the Senate in 1979. In 1988, the then junior senator from the state of Massachusetts, John Kerry, held a hearing on CEDAW. He held it in Boston, and he invited women's organizations from around the state of Massachusetts to kind of weigh in on the treaty. In 1990, which is, both of these are interesting. I mean, this is a field hearing, so it wasn't in Washington, so it's not quite as significant. But this hearing in 1990 is very, very significant, and we have a Republican president, but we have it in the context of the cessation of the Cold War, right, when we actually passed two human rights treaties during that administration, two other human rights treaties. Then in 1994, Clinton becomes president. We have another hearing. In 2002, so Bush is in office, Republican in the presidency, Democrats control the Senate. This is actually interesting because this is in the, you know, the partisan politics of the time. Jim Jeffords switched parties in the beginning of that session. On June 6th, 2002, Jim Jeffords became a Democrat. Within 2 weeks, there were CEDAW hearings declared. And who was at the helm of the hearings? Joe Biden, aided by Barbara Boxer. The arguments that they were making were very much in terms of what was happening at the time. You remember, the US had recently declared war on Afghanistan, and we had done so in part around the rhetoric of saving Afghan women from the Taliban. So Biden and Boxer and their colleagues in the Senate made arguments about, we've gone to war to supposedly to save women from the Taliban. Could we please ratify CEDAW? It didn't go. When Obama came to power, Obama in the presidency, Biden in the vice presidency, Hillary Clinton, Secretary of State, now is the moment. And they start to mobilize people to prepare to ratify the treaty. It seems like it's going to go. But conservative women's organizations within the United States are also keenly aware of this moment, and they are also poised to mobilize in opposition to the treaty. They started a campaign that took a small instance of Belarus's report to the CEDAW committee some years before, in which the committee had suggested to Belarus that promoting Mother's Day as the only way of promoting women's rights was insufficient. So Senator Helms, do you want me to show you the clip of Senator Helms? Yeah, you want to see this. Took it upon himself to frame CEDAW as anti-Mother's Day. This is in 2000.
Mr. President, mothers across America will be showered with love and appreciation this Sunday as an annual expression of love and gratitude for the selfless acts mothers make constantly for their families every day. Sunday is one of the truly special days of the year. It's Mother's Day. Mr. President, Americans have a tradition of honoring mothers dating back to 1914, when the second Sunday of May was first recognized as Mother's Day. And it's especially significant in this year, year 2000, because of the irony that a number of high-profile women in the Clinton administration and in Congress are so vocally supportive of the so-called UN Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women. And they call this CEDAW, C-E-D-A-W, which rhymes, I might add, with hee-haw. In any case, the point is this, Mr.
It goes on. conservative organizations they know more about the treaty than most people in the world. And really, in a context where it's such a high threshold for ratification of treaties, it takes a little bit of mobilization of concern to oppose ratification. There's also a kind of an issue at stake with how supporters of CEDAW are framing their arguments. So those who oppose CEDAW frame it as, if we ratify this treaty, the UN will come in and they will change every aspect of what the American family is like. They'll eliminate Mother's Day. This is a dire threat to Americans, to our way of life. Democrats, on the other hand, say we need to ratify this treaty because it's really good for women around the world. Now, which argument do you think is going to mobilize voters at home? Okay, as much as people care about the status of women around the globe, that's not going to get them out in force, highly mobilized, the way this conservative arguments do. And so Dan, in his opening remarks, referred to the increasingly low chances of ratification. And I think as long as we're in this partisan world, chances for ratification are quite low. That said, supporters of CEDAW have moved their strategy outside the Senate, and they're now mobilizing at the municipal level. And the campaign is called Cities for CEDAW. This San Francisco ratified, you can't actually ratify it as a city, but they ratified CEDAW and the city of San Francisco now adheres to the principles of CEDAW in municipal governance. The city of Los Angeles also is a CEDAW city, and Louisville is a CEDAW city. That's it so far, but who knows? Maybe Norwich could be next. Denise.
So that was great, Lisa, and fascinating to see the history of the Republican Party in, Republican-led government in those early days. But it just begs the question, and going into the 80s, and I'm not really a student of politics, but I associate two big things that I didn't know were changes in the Reagan era. So the change in attitudes toward family planning and abortion rights, clearly, but then also this is part of the question, is this a change, but in this fear and criticism of the UN as a threat to the stability of American laws or whatever. So I'm not sure if that's a change, but I also wonder, in addition, is the resistance then of conservatives and Republicans to CEDAW, is it about human rights, family planning, abortion rights, or is it about resistance to the UN, or which one of those came first now that it's both?
So I know there was a lot of resistance to the formation of the UN, and I know that there's a lot of resistance to the UN in general, kind of because I started looking at it once the treaty was brought into force after 1980. So I can't say with any confidence what was happening in the interim. In terms of abortion politics and kind of gender politics writ large, one of the things that happened, I was going to talk about this today, but it gets a little complicated. So 1975 is International Year of the Women. The Nixon administration supports this wholeheartedly. Congress passes legislation that supports convening 50 national women's conferences in each of the 50 states. In 1976 and 1977. They budgeted $5 million, which was one nickel for each woman in the country. And these conferences were held in each of the 50 states. So we have Congress mobilizing support for women's rights in the US. And it culminated in 1977 with the National Women's Conference in Houston in 1977. Anybody here go to any of these, or remember? Okay. And so these really mobilized feminist constituents. The Republican Party, in the wake of Watergate, was really looking to kind of rebuild. And so women's rights were a very attractive issue. But this is also the context in which opponents in the conservative part of the Republican Party really starts to mobilize. The Mormon Church sent busloads of women to these conferences in order to just basically vote against any provision that was voted upon. And they would just go in, vote no, and then leave. Senator Helms was very involved in the International Women's Year conferences within the United States. He actually held hearings to oppose Congress's use of funds to sponsor these conferences. So you begin to see the opposition politics moving in this period well before Reagan is elected. And it's this mobilization feeds into the success of the conservative wing of the Communist Republican Party in 1980. Stephanie.
I love this book. It's so such incredibly useful research, really. So I wonder if an additional piece of the story goes to what the conception of what are rights, right? So the U.S. has ratified the treaties going to what we might consider more traditional civil and political rights, and torture, civil and political rights, coming in. Some of the racial discrimination convention, civil and political, some is other. But when it comes to the Convention on Discrimination Against Women, the provision on education calls on states to eliminate, to look at the textbooks and eliminate gender stereotyping in textbooks that are used in schools. There's provision that just across the board says that states are supposed to put in place measures to counteract the prejudices that lead to discrimination that are grounded in the idea that men are superior to women. And these, the access to health, again, well, that's not really a human right, you know. Those aren't really rights, and I'm just wondering about that as being a piece of the picture, because the U.S. as you mentioned, has not ratified the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and since Somalia ratified the Convention on the Rights of the Child a couple of weeks ago, now the U.S. is the only, 196 countries have ratified, the U.S. is the only state now. South Sudan ratified it in January, so the U.S. is the only one, and perhaps, you know, the idea that, oh, the government's going to be intruding into the family, you know, another strong argument that women are going to be intruding into the family and so forth. The proper role of government, these aren't really rights, and it's the role of the government. So
Laurie asked a question. So what's this treaty say exactly? And you might have noticed I kind of punted on that one. Because my argument about the treaty isn't about the substance of the claims, because there's this whole long jurisprudence about how those provisions are interpreted and applied. But Stephanie's point about this one, it's Article 5, which calls for ending gender stereotypes. I have to say, the first time I looked at that, I thought, well, good luck with that. Like, that's a thorny issue. And it does cut across, or doesn't sit entirely comfortably with how we think about rights in the United States, which is grounded by the Constitution. Negative rights, right? We don't want the government impinging on our rights. The state shall make no law that violates the rights of American citizens. But CEDAW is really calling for something much deeper, much more profound, and potentially, may I dare to say, a much stronger, more muscular defense of rights that really affect women. And in the last chapter of the book, I make an argument thinking about domestic violence, violence against women. And if you look at Supreme Court cases that have addressed violence against women, my read of it is women do not have a constitutional right to be free from intimate partner violence, because intimate partner violence is not committed by the state. Right, so the Constitution does not protect our rights in that sense. It does not protect rights as a form of discrimination. So CEDAW might actually provide a way to kind of address an issue where the Constitution is silent. Now, is that a politically feasible argument? Probably not, certainly not in this political context. But for me, it helps me think about, you know, what about the question that Stephanie is asking about, you know, we are so confident that our conception of rights is the best one, but there are some lacunas when it comes to really, you know, strong constitutional protection of women's rights that I think, at least I argue, CEDAW could address.
So I came in quite late, so I apologize if you already addressed this in the talk. But you showed that there was, you know, kind of broad bipartisan support for women's rights in CEDAW in the 1970s, that this broke down and became a divisive partisan issue. And another issue that kind of had a similar trajectory is the environment. You have Richard Nixon creating the Environmental Protection Agency by executive order in 1970, and then by the time of the 1980 presidential election, it's become a wedge issue between Carter and Reagan. And I'm wondering if you've looked at the parallels and whether you see it as kind of two examples of a similar trend, or whether these are really separate issues, and how.
No, but I am looking for a new research project. there are a lot of interesting parallels. One parallel, I mentioned that were hearings held in 1994 for CEDAW. Under the Clinton administration, we ratified the Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. I bet you didn't know that, because it wasn't even reported in the newspapers. Now, that may be like, it's no big deal, like we have all the rights we need in terms of law, or, you know. But given the history of the UN, in which the UN was created to mitigate African-American claims, to use it as a tool to enhance rights, the unproblematic, uncontested, unnoticed ratification of the Convention to Eliminate Racial Discrimination is really weird. And I think looking at CEDAW parallel to other treaties has been kind of one direction I've gone in. To be honest, I haven't thought about environment, and I think certainly given where we are now, it'd be a really interesting line of research. Andrew.
Yeah, so you mentioned that in the 70s, back in human rights was a good way for the United States to sort of elevate our standing in the UN. Did you notice anything in your research after, into the 80s, when we started backing away from advocating human rights and women's rights in particular in the UN, did we kind of lose some of that progress that we had made in terms of being able to advocate our agenda in the UN?
Here's something I haven't really talked about. I mean, first of all, it takes a while for UN for CEDAW to kind of gain traction. So it gets ratified in 1980, but it really doesn't start to countries don't start to use it until the late 1980s. And part of why they don't do that is because NGOs start writing what are called shadow reports. So a government will say, "Here's our report. We are in full compliance with the treaty." And then an NGO will say, "Actually, no, you're violating the treaty in all kinds of ways." And so that strengthened the process a little bit. So you don't actually see a lot of use of CEDAW in the UN until after the 1990s, and really after the Cold War ends. In the 1980s, you still have this environment in which basically who ran for CEDAW committee? Delegations from communist bloc countries. So, and they were, communist countries have a very strong commitment to an understanding of gender equality or women's equality in the workplace, in the economic realm. And so they really dominated the CEDAW process. So you do see this conception of rights, but it really kind of evolves slowly. And once the global context changes, then it starts to look more like how we think about rights in the international arena today.
great presentation and great book. Two questions. To what extent do you think did ERA crowd out CEDAW? And the other one, a more complicated, picks up on something that Denise said. If you look at the ratification of treaties historically since World War II, we have gotten dramatically worse at it, and we were terrible to start. So, it took 40 years to ratify the Genocide Convention. Something that in 1948 should have been pretty easy to agree to. And so I guess the question I have is, you can't separate the issues. To what extent do you think it is general American turning away from global governance and allowing others, to come into our houses, come into our families, come into our communities, the whole black helicopter thing? How much of a role is that? Just the conservative women's arguments were very much, a fusion of those themes.
So I started by invoking Article 2 of the Constitution and the institutional threshold for passing treaties, right? So that's kind of where I would go with that. I mean, we certainly have, you invoke the phrase American exceptionalism. The founding of the UN was fraught with, opposition despite John Sloan Dickey's efforts to mobilize support for it, which were successful. So I think those currents have always kind of existed, but how they get expressed and how they matter politically depends on the institutions through which they get channeled. So that's how I think about that. I'm glad you asked about the ERA for two reasons. One, so this is 1975, right, that this convention really starts to take off. Congress passes the Equal Rights Amendment legislation and it goes to the states for ratification in 1972. By the late 1970s, ratification by the states that are required to ratify has really kind of slowed down. In 1980, Congress grants an extension, saying, "Okay, we'll give you a little bit more time to ratify the Equal Rights Amendment." But this is where the focus of women's rights activism for and against was in the 1970s and up until 1982. It was absolutely focused on the Equal Rights Amendment. So there is an argument to be made that, you know, in that sense, ERA crowded out CEDAW, but CEDAW really wasn't what it would become until the late 1980s anyway. And I think once feminists in the US start to see CEDAW, then you see all of the organizations that supported the ERA started supporting CEDAW, and they still do today. So if you look on the websites of Feminist Majority, National Organization for Women, all kinds of organizations, if you have to look a little closely, but they support ratification of CEDAW. I have another argument about there is a movement to reintroduce the struggle, the ratification campaign, on the grounds that this time limit that Congress imposed is unconstitutional. So if that's true, and there's for the ERA, if that's true and there is some legal precedent for that, then you bring the ERA back, you only need three more states, and boom, we have an Equal Rights Amendment. My argument is that the Equal Rights Amendment would kind of get us more of what we already have in terms of rights, and that if you really want something very different, a much stronger defense of women's rights, you should think about CEDAW. So again, a lot of conjecture, not a lot of real politics right now. But you never know, things change.
Are they mutually exclusive, or could both take place?
I think they could both take place. But you know, CEDAW, even though it's difficult to ratify, would probably be a lot easier than ratifying even three more states. And neither one is easy.
So thinking about the Republican Party in the Senate for the last 10 years, too, I'm wondering about moderate Republican women senators.
Me too.
Okay. Well, where are they? No, they exist.
Yeah.
So where are they?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. And I should say, you can easily presume from the way I kind of present these arguments and the fact that I took on this book at all that I support ratification. I certainly would like to see a world in which we have this treaty. I'm not so sure I would go to the mat for ratification right now. I'm not so sure that's the best way to use our political forces that we have, just for the record. And then there are some real legitimate questions that need to be asked about what this would mean domestically. Where are the moderate women? I really think, they came out in defense of CEDAW when Bush was president. 12 members of Congress, some senators, some congresswomen, wrote a letter to the State Department, to Colin Powell, saying, not yet Colin Powell, saying, please ratify CEDAW, please move CEDAW into consideration and act into active consideration. So that was early 1990. By the time hearings were convened on CEDAW, those women began to drop out one by one. And there were, I think, three left by the time the hearings happened. I tried to find out like what happened with those women. It was unsuccessful, but my sense is that conservative women's organizations kind of fingered them and said, by the way, you don't want to be supporting ratification of CEDAW. So my sense is there's more of a story to tell there. But I tell the story in the hopes of saying, like, hey, come on out. It's OK. We need you. We need you back. There was a moment in which, you know, women had a really strong representation in the US Senate across the parties. And they thought, well, if they could bring back that more moderate coalition, there's a chance they could move CEDAW through. But you know, those women included conservative Republican senators, like our own. Brian.
And one thing that I find surprising when I start to look at this is that it seems that human rights organizations, as well as just people on the political left in general, don't seem to really care that much about CEDAW. What do you think explains their lack of mobilization? It seems that if they pushed a little bit, the same way that some of the groups on the right have been doing, they could really kind of raise the prominence of this.
So, I mean, I think part of it is the way they're framing these arguments, right? And it's really powerful arguments. I think, you know, one argument in defense of CEDAW is if the United States were a member, if we were part of the CEDAW group, CEDAW would be all, it's not a really, really strong tool. If you violate CEDAW, they're not going to send an army out to say, hey, Article 4.1, you know, get with the program. That's not how it works. But if the US were at the table, the argument would be that, you know, that it would be a little bit stronger. People would pay a little bit more, even more attention than they do now. But the arguments of those who support the treaty are all focused on its impact outside of the United States. And I mean, that's shifting, right, with the Cities for CEDAW campaign. But my sense is, and this is just a kind of, you know, newspaper level hypothesis, feminist organizations, human rights organizations on the left have been forced into a defensive position on all kinds of issues, and aren't, they're not seeing the forest for the trees on this. So, you know, it's a good question, another research project.
Lisa, that is disturbing. How, can you explain how this would play out in a country such as Saudi Arabia that adopted it?
Absolutely, yeah. It's a great question, because people are like, well, this can't matter because Saudi Arabia adopted it. But the argument is Saudi Arabia did adopt it. That's a tool that women have now that they can use. So Saudi Arabia must go before this committee. They must sit at a room that looks a lot like this room, a little bit bigger, and answer questions from the CEDAW committee. Now, when I first started this research, I thought, yeah, who cares? But then I went to watch the process, and I saw the head of the Soviet delegation like break into a defensive sweat at being pummeled with questions that he knew were coming. And still, he was like incredibly defensive, and it was a difficult conversation. You know, does that mean he's going to go home and be like, okay, I fold. You know, we will have domestic violence legislation. No. But that is one mechanism, one tool that without it, we wouldn't have. NGOs also go to that process, so they're watching their government officials. And when they get back home, if there's freedom of the press, they can say, hey, in Geneva, you promised to do this. So with every country, it's worth asking, how's that process going? How are people using it? In my argument, it's a tool that is an important tool. It may not be what we might want, but it's a tool that can be used in all kinds of circumstances to leverage for change.
So I'm really interested in what you said a couple of minutes ago, that you support it, but you wouldn't go to the mat for it. So why not?
I think it has more to do with me. I'm more of a, you know, I wrote two books that are basically trying to broker a coalition between the Democrats and the Republicans. And in the first book on Chile, it's basically trying to say, hey, right-wing women and left-wing women, you actually have a lot in common. You know, none of those women want to hear that. It's not what they're interested in. And so my own impetus is, how can we broker, you know, kind of consensus, moderation, coalition building? And I think it comes, my like, this is too conflict-laden. It probably tells you more about me than any political rationale. I would like to see it be used to shift the conversation about what's possible. And that was another motivation I had for writing the book. I'm seeing Latin America adopt rules that we can't even imagine in the United States. You know, gender quotas that require a certain percentage of candidates for office to be women, female presidents, you know, quotas for trade unions, all kinds of things that are, they frame in terms of CEDAW that we're just still assuming we're the best. And meanwhile, the world is moving on, and we're not even part of the conversation.
Spontaneous applause.
Yes.